It's often claimed that one of the distinct features of human language is the arbitrariness of the language, that there is nothing inherently inherent about the word inherent, that a rose would smell just as sweet by any other name, that any sound or symbol can correspond to any object, shape, or idea. In fact, Ferdinand de Saussure, one of the fathers of 20th century linguistics, regarded such arbitrariness of sounds and their meanings as one of the first principles of natural languages. Today, I'm going to share three stories with you that reflect on this notion of arbitrariness. And the question I'll be asking is, if the correspondence between sounds and their meanings mere arbitrary expressions of human preference, or if there's a more natural relationship between the two, a relationship defined by the structure and the mechanics of the brain, and perhaps shared by some of our fellow species. So I grew up in a small rural town in northern India. And as I was growing up, I realized soon enough that people in different parts of the country spoke very different languages. I learned in school that the country had 22 official languages defined in four different language categories based on their structures and origins. By some accounts, there are at least 447 living languages in India at the moment. I started wondering about the origins of such diversity. As I traveled the country, it was rather striking the role that language plays in shaping our sense of identities and group affiliations. So as I traveled the country, I went to South India, and there are three different states there, and they speak three major languages, and the word water translates to neer in Telugu, neerina in Kannada, and tanir in Tamil, in the three languages spoken around there. This emergence of variation in words reminded me of evolution of species of birds called green warblers. These birds migrated from the Himalayas all the way to Siberia. And as some of these birds migrated around the eastern and the western side of the Tibetan plateau, they gradually acquired mutations, variations in their genetic structures, morphological features, and songs. And by the time they reached Siberia, they were two distinct species with distinct features and distinct songs. Words in human language also seems to acquire such variations, changes, and diversity as they move along space and time. But that still doesn't answer. How do these words acquire correspondence to specific ideas or concepts or objects in the first place? What's the origin of meaning in language? For centuries, thinkers, linguists, and natural philosophers have been trying to answer the same thing. After all, there are 7,106 living languages on this planet at this moment. Considering the structural and the semantic complexity and diversity of each of these 7,000 languages, trying to derive semantic axioms and understanding how language acquires meaning seems somewhat of a colossal endeavor. And that's true, especially when we try to disengage from our evolutionary past and try to make sense of such innate abilities purely on sociological terms. After all, the ability to speak, to produce, perceive, and make sense of sounds, all these abilities are essentially and inherently biological in nature that serve an evolutionarily adaptive function of social communication. Consider the case of prairie dogs, for an instance. Studies show that these fascinating little creatures display one of the most sophisticated forms of natural communication. This is the prairie dog call for a hawk. And this for a human. Now a coyote. And this for a domestic dog. Not only do they have different names for different species, they can reliably convey various descriptive identifiers as well. For instance, they can tell if the person approaching is wearing a green or a yellow shirt, if the person's short or tall, thin or fat, moving slowly or fastly, and because they live in an area where they're hunted rather frequently, they can tell if the person's carrying a gun or not. And they can tell if the person ever carried a gun in that area before. So it's apparent that there is extensive cultural transformation and transmission of language. But the origin or foundation of our ability to associate sounds with abstract concepts or ideas is not a human novelty. They also have regional dialects, and they can show creativity in the sense that they can associate or produce new sounds with novel objects that they've never seen before. So where does this ability to associate sounds with random objects or new objects come from? That brings us to our third story. This is Professor V.S. Ramachandran. He's very well known for his work on synesthesia or cross-modal interaction in the brain. A few years ago, he was given a TED Talk, and he showed his audience these two shapes to demonstrate this concept. He asked the audience to name these two shapes using a choice of two meaningless words called booba and kiki. Now, if you were to guess which of these shapes is more likely to be called booba and which one kiki, what would you think? Raise your hands if you think the left one is more likely to be called booba and the right one kiki. Almost all of you. A significant majority of you. So, what this shows is that the humans have certain a priori intuitions for corresponding sounds with new objects or ideas or shapes. And you can see this effect in children that are just 2.5 years old. You can also see this effect with familiar objects like oranges or forks. This illustrates how acoustic and visual apparatus in the brain are wired for sound symbolism, the idea that sounds carry meaning in and of themselves. It'll become clear if you were to examine how our brains are organized. So the area in the yellow area is the occipital cortex that processes the visual information. The auditory or the acoustic information is primarily processed in the temporal lobe, and touch information in the somatosensory cortex in the parietal lobe. Ramachandran proposes that there are areas in the brain, areas like inferior parietal lobule, the one highlighted here, that allow us to, that resides on the intersection of the information pathways that connect these different modalities. And this area is further subdivided into two parts called supramarginal gyrus and angular gyrus, and names are not important. But patients who have damage in angular gyrus, they fail to form associations between sounds and some predefined conception of their meaning, like in case of booba and kiki. This interaction between sensory modalities and the perceptual apparatus in the brain suggests that the sound and concept correspondence is a structural necessity defined a priori by the mechanics of our brains, mechanics that are likely shared by some of our fellow species, including prairie dogs. And if that's true, then the origin of meaning in language is neither arbitrary nor uniquely human. Thank you.